Now let's examine how this would change if I wanted to find the electric flux inside the cylinder. Then I'm going to make a Gaussian surface that has my electric flux density on it, as shown here, and that's inside my charge distribution. So what would change in that case? Look at the left-hand side of my problem. I still have the same electric flux density, as shown here, and I still have the same surface, shown here. My limits of integration are even the same, phi going from 0 to 2 pi, and z from minus infinity to infinity. Notice that right here is my r value, and r in this case is less than a, but it's still simply r, so it stays the same, which means that everything on the left-hand side of this equation stays just the same. But what about the right-hand side? On the right-hand side, I want to find the total charge that is enclosed by my Gaussian surface. I can see that that's all of the charge on the inside of this cylinder, but that out here there's a lot of charge that's not included, that's outside of my surface. In this case, what's going to happen is my r is going to go from 0 to r, not 0 to a, because I have not picked up the entire volume charge that was given in my original case. Everything else stays the same though, so this is going to go to r instead of a, and what I'm going to get here is an r cubed. That means that I'm going to end up with r cubed over r, so I'll have 7r squared over 3. And that's what changes when I'm on the inside of my cylinder. Now take a look again. It does not matter what my charge distribution is, my left-hand side always stays the same. So for all cases, my left-hand side, which is the closed surface integral of d dot ds, is going to be 2 pi r times the length of my cylinder, this is the length, times dr. It's always going to be that. The only thing that I'll need to calculate differently from one problem to another is going to be my total charge, or my right-hand side, because this value may be different, or I may have a surface or a line charge instead. So in all cases, what I'm just going to be looking for is the total charge that's inside my Gaussian surface on the right-hand side. So I might as well pre-calculate this for all of my cylindrical cases, and then I only have to be calculating the right-hand side. Now let's look at some possibilities for my right-hand side. In the cylindrical case, for instance, I can't exactly have a point charge, so this does not work for cylindrical. It does for spherical. But I could have a line charge, so a series of charges like this. When I put my Gaussian surface around that line charge, let's suppose that there were 7 coulombs in that line, then part of my total charge would be 7 coulombs. What if I had a surface charge? What if I, on this tin can, I had some charges that were on the surface, not inside? Maybe that is air and there are no charges there, but I do have charges on the surface of this can. Then I would have a QS, and maybe there's 4 coulombs on the outside. If I had been given a charge distribution instead, this would be a rho S ds case. And then my other possibility is the one that you just saw, where we had charges that were distributed radially throughout my volume, and in that case I have a volume charge, and I'm going to find that by doing rho v dv. If you did this problem in physics, you probably originally had a rho v that was constant, which means that you could simply multiply rho v by the volume that you had. But in this class, you cannot assume that this is constant. Most of the time in a cylindrical case, rho v will be given as a function of r.